So in terms of ask, I mean, I think that when you leave this room, what we would like you to have is a bit of a language to talk about responsible tech, and you can decide as individuals or as organizations if this is a movement that you would like to join. So we would like to give you a bit of language, a bit of examples, and then kind of ask you, okay, and where are you? Like, what do you want to be a part of that? Yeah, so let's get started. Okay, so this is our agenda. We're going to deep dive into some of the concepts that Martha mentioned around what is responsible tech. We're going to show you our approach around it and how we think in a system approach way we can make it new normal. We're going to offer you some collaborative group exercise to practice the thinking around responsible tech and show you our approach about how we think we can build this field and to make sure that we do collaborate cross-sector. And kind of share with you next steps. Yeah? Okay, so Martha gave you a few statistics, but it will be interesting. We are not representative here in any case, but it will still be interesting to see how many of you feel that the internet has made your life better as individuals, just like by raising your hand. Okay, so we have like a good 90-something%. It made your life worse. Yeah, you're good. Okay.
It does both.
Both. So somewhere in the middle, you will say. So we have two people saying somewhere.
Can you say
even in the middle, didn't
you? Yeah. No, I don't know. So from the survey we conducted, we got everyone, so 50% of the population, so this was a representative of the UK population, 50% found that they made their life a lot better, some kind of little better, and a really small percent actually said that they had made their life worse. Now, if we will, if you want to take, I heard of, okay. Do you feel the internet has had a positive impact on society?
Can we also have both again?
Yes, okay, but why? Why would you say both?
Well, because the internet lowers the cost of communication that have been previously excluded from, you know, access to communication channels like the news or like, you know, political office. Have a lot more ways to get their message out.
Okay.
However, negative, you know, it's also lowered the cost for negative messages and negative intentions to be spread. So there's a lot, the people who are benefiting differently than they were before, but also were harmed in ways that we weren't before.
Yeah, I agree.
So I think that's a much more complex answer than what we got in our data, because as you can see, the data is actually shows a really big gap. Like 50% say that their life is better because of tech, but only 6 think that they had a really positive impact on society. And this is, I think, not only about the gap. We actually, when we dive deep, this is very weird. I'm sorry. around trade-offs. Trade-offs of technology. So people said that they love the internet. But when we asked about trade-off, for example, between innovation and public service, people found those trade-offs to be unacceptable. So just to make that a bit clearer, I love to buy on Amazon, right? It's cheap and gets to my house. But if that would mean that all the shop in my local neighborhood will close, I might think again. So there are trade-offs. And people definitely feel overwhelmed with the power and potential of the internet, and we are only expecting that to grow. So yes, now we have Facebook as like a big technology and everybody talking about it. What will happen when technologies as machine learning, AI, robotics, Bitcoin will grow? And this is kind of why we really emphasize the point that now is the time for responsible technology. Now is the time to think about it. Now is the time to define it. Now is the time to start researching it, putting metrics and so on. Not as with other technologies, we're kind of like looking back and thinking, what could we have done differently? Which is still very important, but this is a complementary approach. So what is responsible tech? Martha kind of touched upon that. Responsible technology considers the social impact it creates and seeks to understand and minimize its potential unintended consequences. And the exercise we will do will be exactly around that, and we're going to kind of feel that it's not easy, but equally important. So Martha also touched about that, the kind of different values, you can say. And these are not exclusive. Other organizations have been doing amazing work in this field for almost two years, and they have different definitions. But it's a starting point. It's a thing that we'd like to break down and see how we can not bring it only into tech, but also into regulation, into research, and so on.
So dive a little bit deeper than what Martha went into, but we came up with three core concepts that sit underneath and support responsible technology. So the first is context, which is really looking beyond the individual user and considering the greater context and environments that technology operates within. And so that's in considering the impact it can have on institutions, and it's also going back to trade-offs, actually thinking through and capturing what those are. The next one is contribution. And so this is looking at the value that gets exchanged within a technology system. And so value in this case can mean formal labor, as in the money that you pay a team to develop technology. It can mean informal labor, which is when people would enter information, say in the CAPTCHA, that then feeds into a machine learning system. Or it could be your information. If I'm exchanging an email address and access for a service, then that's value being exchanged both ways. So that's the first piece of it, but the second piece is then sharing what those value exchanges are in a very transparent and easily understandable way so that the user actually has the ability and power to make an informed decision about whether or not they agree and accept those trade-offs and those exchanges of value when they use that service. And then the last is continuity, which is really around ensuring best practice throughout the building, creation, maintenance, support of your technology. And so that's inclusive design, safety and security, doing all of your patches, all of those things that should be ubiquitous and yet aren't quite.
Before we dive deeper into what everyone does, I do want to mention that we do not live in the bubble. This is a civic tech conference, and we heard a lot about the work of civic tech, but there are other organizations that are doing amazing work around our responsible and ethical tech. So you can see the logos behind me. I will just throw a few examples. DeepMind has a great ethical and society research program around AI. Omidyar just launched their Society and Tech Solution Lab, and they build and scale solutions for unintended consequences of the internet. There's the new Ada Lovelace Institution. They do also research around understanding different definitions of ethics within tech. So the ecosystem is starting to build. It's very new, but they're a great work, and everyone want to contribute with our own methodologies and our own ways.
Okay, so Dot Everyone, as Martha touched on as well, so this will be really fast, was founded in 2015 by Martha. We're a London-based think tank, and our current mission is to champion responsible technology for the good of everyone. And we do that through researching how technology impacts on society, using that research in order to form different prototypes and testing that we can show what good looks like, and then collaborating and building networks, which is why we are here today, and exactly what Stav just touched on now and will a little bit more later. And also, as Martha mentioned, we've been doing a lot of work in the last year, and what we've really discovered is that if we want to make a difference, then we really have to look at the big picture. And that entails taking a systems approach. And so this ecosystem is very, very complex, and the impact that technology can have on all of these different areas is very interplayed and connected. And so it's really important that we feel that it's really important that we do work in all of these different areas in order to make change cohesively and across the board. So right now, we're actually focused on providing knowledge and ability to all of these different parts of the system in order to make responsible tech the new normal.
Okay, so let's deep dive into some of the data and the research that we do. So we're very much, our starting point is people. It's not users and it's not consumers, it's about how people and kind of what people think and feel around the internet. And our biggest piece of research is this report. It's called the Digital Attitude Report. And we launched this a couple of months ago, and next week actually we're launching the other part. So the first part was around attitudes and feeling towards the internet, and the other part will be about how people understand the internet and if they even understand the internet. So here are a few interesting statistics. Only a third of the people people are aware that data they have not actively chosen to share has been collected. So for example, if your friends tag you in a photo, people don't understand that this can be shared. Fourth, have no idea how internet company makes their money. So I use, you know, we all use Facebook and WhatsApp and LinkedIn all the time. People don't know how, you know, those companies generate any kind of revenue. This is from the new report. We have a specific section on online news and information. So just for example, 62% don't realize the news and information they see online can depend on the people they are connected to on social media. So again, don't really understand how these things work. Only 31% think most news and websites are trustworthy. But this is a good point to say that if you have questions, just ask them. Yeah.
This is from the second part of the report. Yes. Coming out soon.
Yeah. Next week, and it's going to be on our website. Yes.
Where do you get these stats from? These people from, like, when you say people, who do you mean?
So it was nationally represented, the survey across the UK.
Okay.
So 2,500 people were surveyed, and we had interviews and focus groups.
Okay. Sure.
Yeah.
How did you recruit people?
So we took an external research company who was kind of expert in doing national surveys. And all the data can be found in the appendix of the reports.
Sure.
So, yeah, feel free to ask as we go on. And it's interesting who people kind of hold account to this. It's not a tech company. Two-thirds of the government should be helping to ensure companies treat customers, staff, and society fairly. And I find this extremely interesting because in the time that actually a lot of political institutions are more fragile, when it comes to technology, people want to hold their people want government to hold big companies to account. So we say one of the first steps into making the technology responsible tech the new normal is to make people understand actually what is tech, what are their consequences, how do you use it, and what's their what's the impact.
So then that feeds into the government piece. So out of the, based on the research, we kind of came up with a set of policy recommendations for the government. So the first being, we really need government to invest in new forms of public engagement and education that allows people to interact and understand these really, really complex issues in a new way that's not quite been done before or traditionally. We also need to do a bit more research and to develop shared understandings and standards for understandability and transparency. And as we heard from the keynote yesterday, that can be really complex if, like, even the words that we're using to describe these things, you know, it's hard to be agreed on those. And also, we need to set up an independent body that's strong and is able to regulate and hold people accountable for the different problems that people encounter on the internet. But in order to do all of those things, we really need our government leaders to actually understand technology. And so, as Martha had mentioned, we're doing a lot of work within the government in the UK in order to help them bring up upskill. But I think this is something that could very much be used in a lot of other countries across the world.
I'll just emphasize a point about independent body, because I think that's interesting that when we conducted the interviews, people said, you know, in the UK, if I have a problem, I went, as a consumer, I went to buy, I don't know, clothes or even medical, some kind of medicine, I have a problem, I know where to go to. I have a problem on the internet, who do I go to? Who helps me? So that's kind of really emphasized that point. The internet has impact not only on people and consumers, but also in communities. And even though it kind of like enables us to communicate in different ways, I think we should, as a community, we should also have the power to strengthen and protect what matters that is not digital. Or how can we come with community approaches to problems that the internet is causing? So this is an example of a project we did in London with an organization called Citizen Advice. And basically we try to target the problem of pricing discrimination. You might know this problem as pricing personalization, which basically means if you and I get the same, buy the same product online at the same time, we'll probably see different prices. And this is not because of simple supply and demand. This is because we come from different genders and different places, and we have a completely different search history, which is fair to say, is discriminatory by nature. So then we thought, okay, as kind of putting our collective community power together, what can we do around it? And we designed a prototype, Facebook now might steal it, that basically it's a Chrome extension that you can actively choose to plug in, which means that when you go and buy the product, you see what price you get, and you see other people who chose to share their prices, and you can compare. And then that collective power kind of enables you to make decisions around your purchasing on the internet. So this is kind of like how, as community, as sharing information, we can tackle some of these issues that the internet is causing. So yeah, we want to join the dots between social issues and technology. We want to expose them, and we want to not only bring tech solution to community challenge, we want to bring community solution to tech challenges.
Which brings us to the work that we're doing within the technology industry. So in order for technology to actually work with and around communities, then they need to basically understand their responsibilities and the different frameworks that they can operate within. So we've been doing work in this area for just about a year now. And where we started was doing a number of workshops with people within the industry to come up with different aspects of what responsible technology is. And we then took those different aspects and built a prototype program where we got a number of startups to come in as partners. And most of these startups were already having a focus on operating ethically and a positive impact on society. But we asked them a number of very in-depth questions about their business practices and the different types of obstacles that they faced and opportunities that they had around operating more responsibly. And so at the end of that, we actually went back and we interviewed all of our partners around responsible technology and what their thoughts about it were. And we put together a really short video that we'll just play for you guys now.
And not only the customers, but also the people that they interact with as well.
Doing good is good for business, so should embrace that, not just because of the business and commercial outcomes, but because it's good for everyone, socially and environmentally.
I think being trustworthy is not just limited to tech. It's just like a way of seeing business, a way of acting, and a way of being considerate to everything that like is around your business, basically, from your customers to your employees to your shareholders to the community in a broader sense. Which is being trustworthy and being able to be accountable for your actions and where you are.
I think you get one chance to build a relationship with all your stakeholders, and if you're not, if you mess that up, then you might as well not be in business.
Acknowledge that you can't really draw a line as to like what's good and what's bad. It's sort of like a spectrum.
So we're engaging in a journey, and we're trying to find parties that can help us scrutinise what we're doing and provide a framework for us to develop an even richer ethical approach and ethical framework for our business. Nobody gives you that. It's not like a passport or a roadmap. You have to find your way through it.
And the fact that the world changes so fast, it's really hard to keep up. Every time you bring a new stakeholder in, they might want you to do something that benefits them but doesn't benefit some of your other customers and stakeholders.
Because we don't know where we will be in 6 months. It's a product that's evolving a lot. We are like considering so many different new products to add to our portfolio, new things to do, new ways of doing stuff. So it's really hard to, when you're an early stage startup, to do some of the exercises.
I keep seeing this everywhere. More and more people are talking about doing good as good business.
The future will be driven by people who buy because it's ethical. There's a lot still to be done in sort of getting people to think about these things, like what do you sign away when you sign up on a social network online? What happens to your data? Do you know what happens to your data? And are you happy with that?
This will become ever more important as a way to differentiate differentiate yourself and your business model, both to your workforce, the community around you, and your customers.
Shared with you before, and we're now creating a comprehensive system that interplays and supports each piece of it, that provide tools and really practical guidance that can be embedded within an actual sprint cycle in a business that will help you determine whether or not you're being responsible. So the first piece of that is simply the information that you need around what these concepts are and how you can implement them, and that could either be pitching it to your business leaders in order to adopt that practice, or it could be, if you're a lab or an incubator, teaching a startup, the startups within your cohorts, how to implement that. The next is an automated self-assessment tool that will actually ask you guided questions around what you're doing within each of those core concepts, and produce a business dashboard that can be implemented, again, in any business and reviewed by tech leadership. We also have thought exercises around each of the concepts that, again, will help you think through the consequences and the impacts of your technology. So the one for context that we're making will actually be very similar to a board game, where it would literally be the developer sitting around in a room and being able to play a game that would help them tease out how their tech can influence different areas of society. And then the last is a resource guide that will contain a number of best practices and example policies and things that people can leverage to put in place. Yeah, so we're looking to actually embed that system within businesses at the product owner and developer level. And we're working with the same leadership guides that we're creating for government leaders to complement that at the CEO and C-suite level. But now we can get to the fun part.
So we're going to do our exercise very shortly, in two groups, I believe. But let me give one more example before we drill down, and you're probably kind of wondering why there's a horse in the end of the 19th century picture. So a couple of months ago, The Economist, I don't know if you saw it, but you should, did a big report on AVs, on autonomous vehicles, and they did a whole section on foreseen and unforeseen consequences of this new technology. I always think that when The Economist does something, it means that it's the beginning of mainstreaming. So, you know, only maybe in AVs, but I think this example is a really good framework for us to think about these things. So the example goes like this. In the end of the 19th century, the London Times kind of went with this huge call and said, one of the biggest problems, social problems of the time is horse manure. And they predicted by 1940, the entire city of London will be just filled with shit. And this is not only a smelly problem, this is also a social problem because it caused a lot of diseases and bad smell, pollution, and so on. So when the cars came around, they were seen as this amazing innovation to solve this, you know, solution. And for many, it's to solve this problem. And it was in many cases because, again, it doesn't stink, not from shit at least, maybe from other things. But it also had this amazing social impact. It enabled us freedom to go places. It changed the way we shop, with the shopping mall. It really kind of changed our life. But it did have unintended consequences, which today are very clear in the terms of congestion and pollution and accidents. So until today, 1.25 billion people die each year from car accidents. say now they're going to solve. So the statistics go that when IVs will be implemented, the death in the US will drop from 40,000 a year to 40. Okay, and so this is about saving lives. So, you know, amazing social impact. But it will also have different social impact. It will again probably change the way we shop and the way we trade. Now, I don't need to go get a haircut. I can take it in a way to work. One of the interesting examples they said is about, why not? You see, this is us getting creative about how, you know, these technologies will really revolutionize our world. So, like, suddenly, Facebook doesn't seem such a huge thing. But, I mean, it is. Just saying. So another interesting example is around a dating app. Dating service, you say, okay, why would I spend my evening with, like, a stranger when now I have, like, this, like, technology, like, this app that will know much better about my preferences, and I can just share ride my date into work. And then if it doesn't work, you know, all good. So these are kind of like social impact that IVs might generate. And what about unintended consequences? So one thing that I didn't think about, but it's really interesting, is organ transplant. Mm-hmm. So most of the organs today come from young people who die in car accidents. No car accidents, no organs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is a big one. A smaller one, but still very interesting, is that they predict that cigarette consumption will drop because most of the cigarettes are actually being bought in petrol stations, and we won't have petrol stations. So again, this is only what kind of we can think about. So I think this is a very interesting example of how shifts in 150 years will completely change our society, but we should not, and they conclude the article and we kind of agree, that we should not be naive around, oh great, less people will die. We should actually think about what are these unintended consequences and how we shape them before they shape us. Okay, so this is a quick run through, but I think you get the point by now.
Although, I do want to make a quick point. So even if you're building tech for good, your tech can still have unintended consequences. So just because you have all the best intentions in the world, that doesn't mean you're exempt from having, you know, an impact on society that might be negative, whether intended or not. And so this is now the thought exercise. So this is a real tech startup in London that currently has, like, they developed this technology. It's being prototyped and developed now. So it hasn't scaled yet. And you don't need to worry too much about the actual, like, technology and the understanding of it. But essentially, the way this technology works is you are able to log into a virtual reality system and with your mind control a drone. And so the uses that they envision, and they call themselves a tech for good, is that this is going to save a lot of lives. It means in a police situation, you can send, if you have somebody in a house with a gun and you don't know, you can send the drone in instead of a human being. So it reduces risk. Mm-hmm. If there's a wildfire, you don't need to send in firefighters to fight the flaming blazes, you can send in the drone. If someone is lost on sea in a small boat, you can stand on the shore and send the drone out and find them, probably much more effectively than if you were to send out a couple of different boats or a helicopter. Mm-hmm. And so they have all kinds of uses for this technology that they think that can really save lives. But our ask to you is four steps, sorry. But the first piece is, as we mentioned, this is taking a systems approach. There are different parts of the system. So as a group, choose which part of the system you would actually like to be. And then we're going to ask you to come up with what the different impacts and consequences of this technology could actually be. Not just its intended uses, but its unintended ones. Then we're going to ask you, within your chosen role, what would you do to reduce or minimize those impacts? Then we'll just have you kind of share what you've come up with.
When we put on your desk more information, so this is an article about this company, I think it was in the Forbes, we're not making this up. This is actual technology, and also all the questions that you have, like if you want to.
Yeah.
These are
assuming it will in a minute.
Yes. And we also have in-depth instructions on each piece of the steps for this. So, if you wanted to say you were a community, you could be the Mennonites.
Mm-hmm.
If you wanted to be government, you could either be like a local government, like the City of London, mm-hmm. or the UN.
Mm-hmm.
So civil society is essentially what we are here, generally a think tank or a human rights organization.
Okay. So two and doesn't really change depending on who you are?
No.
Right, but three and four.
But three and four.
I'm going to nip to the loo and then I'm going to come back and do this wholeheartedly.
Oh yeah, they're also a tech for good and there's a lot of PR around diversity. Mm-hmm. So this is more the techie part. I don't know if there's something on the other side. Probably not.
Mm-hmm. How do you change those bullets? Is
that? How's that armor?
What? Well, I guess for fire, for fire. Yeah. So let's assume it's like a super drain that can do everything.
And not think about
it. Not worry about it, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
What does that mean, choose a
part? Choose a part of the system, an individual, community, government.
So who do you want to, like, by what lens do you want to think about?
Okay,
what
do we want to be? Okay. Do we want to be the government, like the industry?
What do you fancy, government?
Really? Oh, I want to be the Prime Minister in the end.
Why not? I don't mind.
Yeah, I don't have strong opinions.
Okay.
But we're going to form a coalition.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's part of it.
So, identify some of the potential impacts and consequences of this.
That is the most difficult one.
Narrow it down to the top two you can answer. So, practical impacts as an individual.
How do you best use this tag in your chosen?
Okay, switch to voice.
Maybe as an individual, you
know,
let's
do that. Choose, throw everything you have. It doesn't really matter, which ones.
Yeah,
okay. Like just everything.
Yeah.
Actually, because you come from both tech and government, it could be interesting to get the different things.
How would you best use tech in your chosen role?
Yes. If I was an individual choosing this tech, I mean, like, it would just be for fun, right? But I mean, if you control a drone with your mind, sounds like quite fun. Thing to be able to do.
Yeah.
I think that's, I think like gaming probably
can take sick pictures.
Yeah, exactly.
But then.
Or for crime, if you were like an individual that was a bit like morally, like I just think you could use that for like going in someone, checking out like scanning a place to see if you want to burgle it or not, for example.
As a woman walking, if I'll just have a drone above me, I'll feel much safer walking in the streets of Rio at night, for example.
Or more vulnerable. By someone.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think being stalked by like a drone sounds quite daunting. Not
yeah, that does sound like
too much Black Mirror.
But is unintended consequences rich people, for example, it's intended to use by the police. But what happens if private hands can get a hold of it?
Yeah, could create or deepen our existing inequalities.
While it will be an expensive. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Depends on how, I think the nearest thing is like delivery drones, isn't it? I've seen that actually looks like this. Like, you know, the ones that are test ones.
But even if it's expensive now, and we're thinking 20 years, like, again, when you think about this. Think about scale.
But we can also think as an individual what our local government could use this for.
Mm.
So there's this. There's this podcast where they talk about using drones to chase car robberies. They used it somewhere in a town in the US, maybe. I don't know, and it reduced the crime quite a lot because
they could, they basically they were scanning the town 24/7 with an airplane or a drone. And then they would actually see when the robbery was happening, and you could trace the car where the robbers would escape.
Surveillance.
But that comes with privacy. And
yeah, but that's good. Let's put it all, because I think, yeah, privacy is a huge issue here.
Mm.
How could a bad actor exploit this tech?
Hacking.
Lure the police into area. The police think there's nothing wrong because the drone reported nothing wrong.
Oh, wow. What's going on in that mind? That was really interesting.
Well, it's like in general, like when you rely on tech to give you signal about like about the world, you like tend to be overconfident, right?
Mm.
Like there was the only thing that's fine is like the fake news study where Facebook tried to mark stories as not being true, and then it makes people more likely to trust stories that aren't marked, but like they could still be false, just that Facebook doesn't know.
Yeah,
have you seen the Black Mirror episode with the bees?
So, Big Brother, we're talking about Big Brother.
Basically,
I think that with the lens of community.
Yeah. We're going to ask you, within your chosen role, what would you do to minimize
the risk?
Yeah. So if you're in government, you would do something very different.
So we have to decide to.
So this is just a few paragraphs on how they're envisioning their tech.
I mean, I think we should be government because we have a lot of power, and the things that we'll come up with will be hilarious and wrong.
So local government? National?
Should we go national?
National.
Most fun.
Probably the hardest also.
Create a department of transport.
Yeah. So I guess one of the other questions would be, as a national government, how would you best use this technology? Would you buy it? What scenarios would you use it in?
Okay, would you or bad government?
I don't think anyone sets out to be bad.
Yeah. But this tech could be used for good.
I mean, democratic or not democratic?
We're definitely democratic.
That is the next question.
If we were just a government, not a department, there's a really horrible, obvious one. It could be used for the Defense Department. But they could just think of a war instead of having one.
Mm-hmm.
That's
a virtual warfare.
Yeah. They already use drone technology.
But yeah, so this is virtual warfare, and also using drones to jump bombs and
sorry, but this is a bit too much.